of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hand, my name is written on his heart. I know that
come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at his feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how his love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave, you free every captive, break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things.
Sing, oh hero.
Oh hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive, break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things.
Sing, oh hero.
Oh hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. Free every captive, break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, waking alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things.
You may be seated. Welcome. You are gathered here together with the Christians at the church at 1548 Heights. We're glad to have you back, Alf. We're glad to have you back. Alf's been gone to Malaysia. And even though he's not here today, I want you all to hug Randy Burkhalter when you see him, because it's his birthday on Halloween. So he's very special. So this morning, if you're new with us, you're welcome to our group. Just a few words about who we are. We are Christians, and we have old-fashioned paperwork, or we have a church app, and we would like for you to do both. If you go on the app, you can sign up for our newsletter and stay in touch. You can see what all happens here. This, though, if you're new, we'd love to have you give us a way that we can contact you. so that we can reach out and say thank you for coming. And on the back is a space for prayer requests. Again, the app, the paper. But we pray as a group every Wednesday night for your request and your intercession. Please join us on Wednesday night sometime and pray with us. I just want to let you know, if you're new, that we do take communion at the front. It's an open table. And that our children are welcome until after communion, and then those who are five and under will go to the back. And so let's stand and continue to sing to the Lord.
Awesome. Thank you, Ann. So exciting to be here with you all today. We serve an amazing God. He's so great, and he's so far beyond our understanding or our comprehension. And yet, we have the opportunity to pour out our worship and our praise to him, even in our limited understanding. And it's just, he's so far above us, so far beyond us. But this morning, I want to encourage you to set your mind on him, to think about how far above he is and how higher his ways are than ours. How good he is, how great he is, how faithful he is. So as we sing the song, let's turn our mind, our hearts, our attention to him and declare his worth this morning.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world's Zions have made, and I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed.
Then sings
my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the thing that God his son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin.
Then sings
my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. And he wraps himself in light. Darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. Now great is our God. Sing with me out. Great is our God. Don't see how great, how great is our God.
H to H.
Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son. Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Don't see how great is our God.
Sing that again, how great is our God.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Don't see how great is our God.
He's the name above all names. Sing this out.
Name above all names.
Name above all names. Sing that out this morning.
He's a name above all names. You are worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God.
How great is our God. One last time.
And how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great is our God. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to how great thou art, how great thou art. And then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art.
This morning on our way here to church, I was listening to the radio, and there was a commercial that came on, and I found it very fascinating. The commercial was for California Psychics, and it discussed finding out the answers that you want to know, and you can contact them directly, you can pay them, and they will give you all the answers that you need. And I thought, wow, what a deal. Right now, we're going to speak to our Father directly, and we get to ask him what we want to ask him. We don't have to go through anyone else. We get to do it ourselves. And we get to know all the answers because he's given them to us. And we might not like the answers the way they arrive, but he's always good with his answers. He's always true. Pray with me, please. Father, we're so grateful that we have this body that we belong to, that is so important to us, but so important to this community as well. With everything that's going on in the world, we ask that you bring your light into this world and you bring civility into what's happening. You're the reason why we're here, and you're the reason why we strive to connect with others and to teach them about Jesus and to show them the salvation that they can get. We want to pray for those that we support, for our ministries. And this morning we want to pray for E2 Brazil and the Kaiser family and everything that they're doing down there and the support that we can give them. And Lord, guide them and be with them in the incredible great work that they're doing. And then be with us as a congregation that we can support them and we can support our other ministries, Main Street Ministries and Arms of Hope, and anything else that touches people in this community and shows them that Jesus is the way, and that's the only way, is through Jesus. Pray all this in Christ's name. Amen.
You can have it all, every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now. You can have it all, every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. Oh, the joy I found surrendering my crowns at the feet of the King, who surrendered everything. Oh, the peace that comes when I'm broken and undone by your unfailing grace. I can lift my voice and say, you can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world, take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. Every part of my world, take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. There is no greater call than giving you my all. I lay it all down, I lay it all down. There is no greater love, no higher name above. I lay it all down, I lay it all down. There is no greater call than giving you my all. I lay it all down, I lay it all down. There is no greater love, no higher name above. I lay it all down, I lay it all down. You can have it all. Every part of my world, and take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. You can have it all. Every part of my world. Take this life and breathe on. This heart that is now.
Momentous. In Luke's account of the crucifixion, many voiced the same opinion of Jesus, whether Jewish leaders, Roman soldiers, even the thief on the cross, they all mock Jesus with the same demand, save yourself. The common assumption is that anyone with godly power would use it to come down from the cross, and the fact that Jesus remains proves his impotence. So it's surprising that one thief hears that disdain and comes to a completely different conclusion. He looks at Jesus and looks past this moment and sees Jesus not on a cross, but on a throne. And he tells his companion, "We're getting what we deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." And then he says, "Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom." For this man, the proof of Jesus' power lies not in his escape, but his acceptance of an unjust death. It's not that Jesus cannot, but he will not avoid suffering. His power is made perfect in weakness. And it's that willing weakness that awakens in this criminal the desire and hope of a welcome, because Jesus is the one who chooses to die with him. And this morning, as we take this Lord's Supper, the emblems of Jesus' body and blood remind us that we can never be in a place so desolate, so despairing, that Jesus is not right there with us, hanging on the cross, sharing our grief or pain. And at the same time, the bread and the cup testify that there is always something beyond this moment that is so overwhelming. Because Jesus not only died, he came into a kingdom where each moment he stands to welcome us. Would you please stand and pray the Lord's Prayer with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This is an open table. Everyone is welcome to come forward.
Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of hope, what depths of peace, the fears are sail and striving sea. Comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I'll stand. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave, he rose again. Here as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man could ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
This time in our service, I'd like to invite you to stand with us, and we're going to sing the doxology together in light of all of God's provisions to us. We get to pour our hearts back out and worship and offering and praise to him this morning. So would you sing with me?
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Even lower. Here we go. Pop it off. Okay. So the lights are on. The AC is okay. There's bulletins printed. There's communion. I think Matt would be proud. So we those are his main. I'm sure. I hope he's watching. I know he'll watch us later. So we're okay. We're okay. We're on time. That. Okay, awesome. So children are dismissed, infants to age 4 for tiny fellowship. Well, I am very excited to invite Mark Kaiser to come and give us the word. They're coming all the way from E2 Sao Paulo. They've been here for a couple of days in the city, trying new things, picking up menus to replicate, duplicate for their kafela. They've met with many of you, came to small group, have had good conversations, and I just want to thank this church for their endless support to all of our partners, including the Kaisers and their kingdom work in Sao Paulo that I got to just witness about a month ago. I am very happy that you all here, and I thank Mark for biting into the sermon today and also doing that right after our departure of Matt. So we're going to be good, church. We're going to be okay. God always provides. We've seen that through the Kaisers, both personally and through conversation. And also we've seen that for this church. So Mark, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Yvonne. Church, it's really good to be with you this morning. Thank you for the invitation. We've had a really good time since we arrived in Houston, and we always do. So thank you for treating us so well. You might notice one of the smaller members of my family is a little distraught this morning because we are really looking forward. We remember the Halloween celebration with you guys last year and how much we enjoyed that. And it's when you're with a place that you're well-received, it's hard to leave. And so thank you for that reception. It means a lot to me as a dad and as a ministry partner to be in a church and in a place that my kids also enjoy being as we serve. And so thank you very much. As you mentioned, the ministry partners, it's really an honor to be part of this ministry team and participate in this kingdom with you. You guys have really good partners. I don't know if you know Arms of Hope. They actually came with Kevin Huddleston down to E2 once, and some of the kids of Arms of Hope were part of the youth camp that we lead. And now I'm blanking on the other ministry, Main Street. Yes, thank you. I had the privilege of meeting Main Street Ministries this week and sitting down with Iz and being inspired by the work that she's doing. She actually works in an area that we I'm pursuing to grow in. I work a lot with individuals who are in the process of coming out of homelessness, so a little bit earlier on in the process than where Iz usually works. And we've done a lot of work with the hands-on and haven't done as much in the preparation of the cognitive skills that she has done so well. And so it was terrific this week to sit down with her and learn and walk away with some material of the program that she uses. And just to be a part of this partnership of kingdom. The kingdom always strikes me as something very mutual. It's blessing that flows in all directions. And so it's been tremendous to be a part of that. I'm going to put on just the first image. This is the church leadership team that Ali and I have the privilege to work with in E2. We're part of this group of 10 individuals who leads the congregation in E2. And we also lead the ministry of Crescimento Limpo. Crescimento Limpo, literally, it means clean growth. And it is a supportive housing program in a Christian environment to enable recovery from homelessness. And this started years back when we met with individuals from the street. You can go to the next slide. We started a lunch in our house and built a friendship with individuals who are living on the street. And as this group of homeless individuals came, they started asking for help to get into drug rehab. And so we saw them go into drug rehab, graduate, come out sober, but have nowhere to go, and we couldn't find anyone working in that area, and in that we found our calling. So now we work with a housing program, which is the next image. This is the house of Crescimento Limpo. We work with housing. We also work with work partnership. So the next slide shows some of our residents in the work programs of Crescimento Limpo. One of our guys doing some welding in our carpentry shop. This is our farm in the middle with Carlos, a Venezuelan refugee who leads the farm. And again, the carpentry shop, Jose, who did a lot of really good work in the carpentry shop. We do the work partnership as a way of coming alongside our residents as partners and seeing them grow in action to also be able to do a reflective discipleship. So the next image is at our farm, having devotional in the morning, having work experience with the guys. There's also a lot of material to reflect on in terms of just the daily frustrations of every life. And as we work together, we're able to see some of the things come out that need to be worked on as a means of changing life. Something that I think is always kind of interesting, when I describe our ministry as a ministry that is social work heavy and does a lot of work in terms of helping people, individuals stay housed and deal with their recovery, people often ask me, I mean, do you also preach the gospel? And absolutely, it is by these many points of contact that we're able to preach the gospel as a new way of life, not just as something that we talk about, but as something that we live out and have a lot of content to work through the living of that out, the working out of our salvation before God as we learn to live in a new way. I'm going to share a little bit this morning from Scripture. This is a good day for me. I'm getting to share about a ministry that I love and share a Scripture that has always fascinated me. And so thank you for that opportunity. We're going to look at Luke 16, if you want to look at it. I'm going to read that. But first, I want to speak a little bit about the what was happening going into this text. And so the context of this Scripture, Jesus is with his disciples, and some Pharisees come along, and they see him with these tax collectors and sinners, and they question, why is he with these disdainable characters? And so Jesus sees that, and he tells them three stories. He tells them the story of a lost sheep, who the pastor went out, left 99, to go and find, and came back and celebrated this lost sheep and called others in to celebrate that he had found him. He tells the story of the lost coin, that a woman turns her house upside down and she sweeps everywhere until she finds her lost coin. She calls in her friends and says, celebrate with me, I've found my coin. He tells the story of the lost son, who asks for his inheritance. He goes off and wastes it in wild living, and when he comes to himself, he comes back asking to be received, and his father runs out and he receives him, comes in, throws a celebration, and the brother comes home and is standoffish. And so the father comes out and he speaks to this resistant son, and he says to him, we have the affirmation of the father saying, we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he's found. And so what Jesus is doing is he's saying, if you're wondering how I feel about the characters that surround me, these characters who are sinners, who you look down upon, I celebrate them. And that is the main theme throughout these three stories, is Jesus looks at his disciples, he looks at these individuals who others would put to the side, and he celebrates having them back. And then in Luke 16, there's a pivot. And he's not speaking right now to the Pharisees. He's speaking to his disciples. And he has a moment of talking to them about how do we interact within this system that isn't always the kingdom? How do we live with worldly wealth in this place in which we live? And I'm going to read in chapter 16 of Luke. Jesus told the disciples, there was a rich man whose manager was accused of wasting his possessions. So he called him in and asks him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your management, because you cannot be manager any longer. The manager said to himself, what shall I do now? My master is taking away my job. I'm not strong enough to dig. And if I lose my job here, I'm not strong enough to dig. I'm ashamed to beg. I know what I'll do, so that when I lose my job here, people will welcome me into their houses. So he called each one of his master's debtors, and he asks the first, how much do you owe my master? 800 gallons of olive oil, he replied. The manager told him, take your bill, sit down quickly, and make it 400. Then he asked the second, how much do you owe? 1,000 bushels of wheat, he replied. He told him, take your bill, make it 800. The master commended the dishonest servant because he had acted shrewdly. For the people of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own kind than the people of the light. I tell you, this is Jesus speaking to his disciples, I tell you, use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves, so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? If you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and despise the other, either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. The Pharisees, who loved money, heard all of this and were sneering at Jesus. And he said to them, "You are the ones who justify yourselves in the eyes of men, but God knows your hearts. What is highly valued among men is detestable in God's sight." So in this parable, we have a servant who is facing a moment of crisis. And a moment of crisis, the beauty of a moment of crisis is that it's a place of change. You can't stay the same. When you're in this moment, something's got to give. You can't stay here. And so the servant, he makes a decision, and he says, I'm going to use my moment to extend grace to also be able to receive that grace. And CL, Crescimento Limpo, our ministry, is built on that extension of grace. And we've basically put structure around that extension of grace to be able to see that grace multiply. And his bold teaching on wealth is that we use worldly wealth to gain friends. That's something that I wouldn't put it that way. I wouldn't say that way, but these are Jesus' words. Use worldly wealth to gain friends for yourselves so that when it is gone, you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. So let me talk a little bit about how CL puts that into a structure of ministry. The next screen is of the halfway house. CL, like I said, it's a place where there's a chance to rebuild in a Christian environment. Individuals come to us either straight off the streets or from drug rehab centers. Some come from a place of domestic violence, but they all come in this process of rebuilding their lives. And what we put is an offer of a Christian environment and the Christian counsel as you pursue how to live that out. Our next tool is a place that we call the Cafella. It started as a garden, it's the next slide. And as a garden, I was looking for a place to work alongside the house residents to go beyond talk. And I figured anyone can step into a garden and have something to offer as a partner. And so I opened a garden to create partnership. The garden progressed and over time has become a cafe where we're able to offer employment to many of the individuals who have come through CL. It's a place of employment, of professional accompaniment for our residents. And it's also a place for the many residents of E2 to come and have good food and a good environment, different offerings of healthy culture, and the light of Christ. That's something that you don't spend much time at Cafella before you realize it's a place of a Christian ministry. It's also a place where we receive in the homeless on Sunday mornings to have breakfast and also to speak of that which we can offer if they're willing. And it creates a really interesting connection of church members that come and do the volunteering and serve the breakfast, and Cafella clients who hear about this as they're having lunch at Cafella and ask, "How do I get involved?" And that's the first place we can come. This moment is where they're all standing for a word of hope. I always bring some short message to speak to them and a prayer before we eat. And so the many clients of Cafella come and they're given that glimpse of the kingdom as they hand out coffee and bread. And then the next is our work projects. Again, the work projects allow us to need our residents. You know, often we can go throughout our interactions with the poor always being the one who has, and our friends always being the ones who need. And I don't think that's kingdom. That's not what kingdom looks like to me. Kingdom is much more mutual. And so these work projects allow us to need our residents. And what they've created goes so much beyond what I could create, what I could do on my own, or just what our team could do. And so in these work projects, we have structured first a garden, then a beautiful cafe, and then a small farm that you see in the center here. All of this through their work. Yeah, you can go ahead and put the farm on. And it's a place of spiritual accompaniment, these work projects, where, like I said, the many things that come up, the frustrations of receiving tasks and having to show up on time day after day and You know, all of these things are things that we get to work through in terms of what does our new identity speak to or have to say to that. And this ministry is also in a place of transition, it's a place of crisis, a place where things are going to have to change in a couple of different areas. In the next image, you'll see some of our friends on the far right is Rogério. Rogério is a longtime member of our ministry, but he's being called forward right now. He and his wife are going to go to Mozambique as missionaries. And so he's in the process of stepping out, and we're in the process of training some of our house residents to fill in his shoes. And so front and center, you'll see Rodrigo. And Rodrigo has a fascinating story that I really think is cool. He, because of interactions where he stole, he was sent to prison. And in prison, he found himself in a scenario where the cell that he was in had a culture of crime. And because he was there, he was kind of being pushed into this life of crime. And so as he was thinking, how do I get away from this? This isn't the life that I wanted to live. In Brazil, generally, there's the way prisons work, there's about 8 cells that open up into a patio, and each cell kind of has its culture, and usually a patio will have one church cell. And so he thought, to get out of the being pushed into crime, I'm going to ask to be transferred to church cell. He wasn't a Christian. He really didn't have any desire to be a Christian. He just didn't want to get into crime. So he asked to get in the church cell, and but then you have to prove it, because it's not easy to stay in church cell. And so the individuals there forced him to, you know, every morning you have to be reading the Bible all morning long. And he was telling me about this. He's like, and you can't even pretend, because they're just standing there watching you. And so you actually have to read. And so he's reading, and then you can't just participate also. To stay in church cell, you also have to help lead the services. And so he found himself having to come up with a sermon and preach in church cell. And by that, he ended up not wanting to, realizing this is true, this is good, this is what I want to live, and he became a Christian. And so he went from prison, he went to a therapeutic community, and from there, a rehab center, he came to CL. And at CL, he's been working alongside us, and he made clear from the beginning, you know, what I really want is to stay connected to you guys, to continue to learn this new way of life. And as Rogério is looking to move to Africa, Rodrigo also has a lot of abilities that are in the area where Rogério served, of the maintenance of CL and the upkeep. And so I said, okay, let's come alongside us, help us carry this ministry forward, and help us work alongside the individuals who are coming into CL. And so that's Rodrigo. Bruno is right next to Rodrigo, between Carlos and Red. In a conversation with Bruno at the halfway house, he was telling me how his dream is to accompany individuals who are coming off the street and finding their way. And he wants to work alongside them as they step into a working career. And so he's telling me all this as I'm in the process of figuring out who is going to play that role that Rogério is stepping out of. And so the two of them now are being trained in partnership. Actually, the three individuals you see there, Carlos and Red, he's our Venezuelan refugee who is taking over all of the leadership of the farm. But these individuals are coming alongside us as individuals who needed help, who needed a hand as they were in this moment of crisis and change. But they also brought the help that we needed. You know, the interesting thing about worldly wealth is worldly wealth will either be used to shut these individuals out or to welcome them in. And we're going to encounter these individuals again. I think something that the Bible and the gospel offers us is the opportunity and the calling to encounter these individuals again, not as a threat, not as individuals that we're trying to seclude ourselves from, but as partners and as fellow sons and daughters of God, sons of God extending the grace of God forward. And another transition that we're in CL, this farm that you see us at here is actually we're 4.5 years into a 5-year contract, and it's going away. And it's a place where the owner of this farm is going to build his house there. So we're no longer going to have access to it. And so we're in the process of figuring out, how do we do all of this process now without the farm? It's also the place where the kitchen of our cafe is, our production kitchen. And so right now we're in the process of building a new facility. It's the next slide. This is a, if it comes up, it's a kitchen facility that a friend of ours architected to be a kitchen on the existing lot of the Cafella, which we were able to purchase 2.5 years ago. It'll have a production kitchen where we'll be able to supply the cafe and do culinary classes to teach the trade, and also a space above it to have classes. And so that's why I'm doing everything I can to learn as fast as I can about the more cognitive aspect of how you help in this transition out of homelessness into a new way of life. And so that's what we're looking at doing there. And so I want to go back. You can go back to the previous slide. Verse 11 of the scripture. Jesus says, "If you've not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches?" And the question that this all asks in my mind is, what is it to be trustworthy with worldly wealth? You know, there's a lot of culture around what trustworthy means in corporate culture. And, you know, in corporate culture, kind of one of the basic rules that I understand is you use all of the resources to maximize profit for the shareholders. And, you know, even you may do a lot of things that are for the good of the community, and generally those things also kind of carry this purpose of, we want to be well seen so people will be comfortable in working alongside us and buying from us and maximize the profit from our shareholders. And so that's what was expected of this shrewd manager. And I think it's interesting that Jesus puts this shrewd manager out, and he does something that it was seen as that as dishonest within his company. But Jesus says, see, people of the world, they know better how to work with worldly riches than we do. Use the worldly wealth to gain friends so that you will be welcomed into eternal dwellings. This is how I see that being done, in terms of taking the wealth that we have, taking the resources that are put in our hand, and finding those that have not been welcomed in as friends, and allowing them, not necessarily even convincing them. The word of Christ speaks for itself. Life speaks for itself. People are hungry for life, and often they find a dead-end path as they try to live a better life. But as we are given resources, may we use those resources to create a path forward for our friends, so that we can also be received into eternal dwellings alongside them, so that we can receive them back as our friends and as our brothers. So we have to make a choice, though, between corporate culture, kingdom culture, as we interact with these things. He also says, if you haven't been trustworthy with worldly riches, who will give you real riches? So what are real riches? It's not just dollars or reais, the Brazilian currency. It's not just what we hold, but it is these partnerships. It is these moments of being able to receive others as sons and daughters of God. I love family reunions, and there's something so rich about getting together with family when you can rejoice together and be together in peace and harmony. And that's what kingdom allows. It allows taking that circle of who we call ours and expanding it and expanding it and expanding it until there's no one left outside that circle that we know as ours. The Pharisees heard all this, and they sneered because they loved money. Jesus says, you can't serve both God and money. You got to choose. What is valued among men is detestable in God's sight, he says to these Pharisees. And so we have this choice of how do we use what God has put in our hands. And I just want to say, it is a rich life that God allows us to live when we trust him with that, when we trust him to be able to lose some in terms of worldly wealth and gain so much in terms of kingdom wealth. And so First, thank you for receiving us as partners as you live this out. And I want to also say this is ours to continue to live out here, there, where we are, and to the ends of the earth, that the individuals who will come across the sons and daughters of God will be seen as true riches and be given the opportunity to be partners in kingdom. Thank you. Lord, thank you for this place. Thank you for this house of worship to you and inclusion of our neighbors. And I pray that you continue to use us, as your sons and daughters to bless both here in Houston, in E2, and to the ends of the earth. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mark. That was inspiring to hear. Let's go ahead and stand, everybody, and we will close our service with one final song of worship together.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you.
Jesus, the name.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh, we live for you, God.
Sing holy.
Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. I will build my life upon your love. It is a there is. none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Hello, church. As Mark said, it's been a joy and a pleasure to be with you this week. So thank you for opening up your time and your hearts and your homes for us. This is my chance to say you are all invited to come to Brazil, okay? And that's not a joke. If you know us, you know that we will make space, we will make time, we will pick you up at the airport. It is a direct flight from Houston to São Paulo, so you don't have great excuses. Or try me, because I've done it. Like I've convinced people who seemed unconvincible. But it would be a joy to show you what is happening, not for you just to hear the stories, but for you to go and meet and hug the people and eat our lettuce and go to Cafela and dance full hall with us. It would be a great delight. We end our service in Brazil every Sunday with a blessing. And this is a blessing that we shared with you last time as well. But I would like to say it in Portuguese over you, and then I'll translate it so you know what it is that you're living with. Que a paz de Deus vá contigo, por onde quer que ele te enviar. Que ele te guie pelo deserto e que ele te proteja pela tempestade. Que ele te traga de volta regozijando pelas maravilhas que ele tem te mostrado. E que ele te traga de volta regozijando mais uma vez pelas nossas portas. And that means, may the peace of God go with you wherever he may send you this week. May he guide you through the desert and protect you through the storms. May he bring you back rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you back rejoicing once again through these doors. Go in peace. May you have a blessed week.
My Savior and my God.